प्राइम एशिया टेलीविजन के सारे ही दर्शकों को संजीव तवंदा सत श्री अकाल नमस्कार आदाब दोस्तों प्राइम इलेक्शन प्रोग्राम असी पिछले काफ़ी दिनों रीजनल काउंसलर्स और स्कूल ट्रस्टीज एंड सिटी काउंसलर्स इंटरव्यू किया उन्होंने डिबेट्स कराई और तुसी काफ़ी इन्फॉर्मेशन लई और अज तुसी मिल रहे हो प्राइम एशिया टेलीविजन के उत्ते ब्रैम्पटन द मेयर हरवरशिप मैडम लिंडा जाफरी मैम welcome at Prime Asia.
Nice to be back.
The most important question which every Bramptonian will be asking is how did you made Brampton a better city in the last 4 years?
Well, for those that were watching 4 years ago, they saw a council that was in the news for all the wrong reasons. We were at the front page of the Toronto Star many times because of lawsuits, because of bad financial management and the fact that all of our council were under a criminal investigation with regards to their expenses. So when I ran, I had a very strong mandate to do things differently, to provide transparency and accountability. And one of the first things I did to demonstrate how much I wanted to have a different narrative, excuse me, to be around what was happening at the city of Brampton was I lowered my salary by $50,000. I brought in a provincial auditor to look at the books to tell us exactly where we were financially. And he told us that our organization was like a triangle, too heavy at the top and very skinny at the bottom. So what we've done is we've done a major corporate restructuring and almost all of the major highly paid executives in our organization are gone. It's a flatter organization. It saves us $2 million every single year, but more importantly, it provides better customer service. The other reason that I think I've made a promise and delivered it is I promised we would attract a university, and Ryerson University is now our partner and will be building in the city of Brampton for the first time as the ninth largest city in Canada, the second fastest growing. We finally have a university that will be coming, will be bringing a good education to our residents, and I think those are important initiatives that I started in this first 4 years.
Congratulations, ma'am, for bringing the university. But your opponents, they basically say it's a satellite university, it's on a parking lot, we couldn't bring the full university. What's your take on that?
I think it's easy to sit in your armchair and make a criticism of a university. The city of Brampton had no university when I arrived, and now we have a university. This is a great university, and if most people like me who went to a university like Arundale campus at U of T, we think of universities as lawns and trees and buildings. Those are old concepts of what hospitals and universities look like. They don't look the way we used to remember them. This university is going to deliver a National Center for Cybersecurity. It's the first of many buildings. If you go down to Ryerson in Toronto right now, it's smack dab in the middle of Yonge and Dundas Street. It's one building, but it has a whole group of probably 25 buildings around it that support the campus. This is the beginning for us. You have to start somewhere. And Ryerson is a city builder. It's going to change our downtown. It's becoming a magnet because I have businesses in other countries who want to come to Brampton now because Ryerson made the commitment. I realize that people are nervous about what it will look like, but this is a good nervous to have because they're actually attracting partners. In fact, the Chang School is part of it. Sheridan is part of it. This is going to be a terrific, positive addition to our city. And our council, all of our council, unanimously agreed to support the university campus by putting $150 million into our downtown. A new central library, a new center for innovation that will support what the university is doing. This is going to be terrific. I'm very proud of what we did.
Madam Mayor, you are now almost 2 weeks away from the election. Mm-hmm. Who's the biggest threat, you think, in this election to you?
We're 13 days away from an election, and for me, the biggest threat is people staying home. That, to me, is the biggest threat. Most people don't vote in municipal elections. Right now, one in three people votes. And if you stay home and think, well, municipal politics doesn't matter, that's the biggest threat to me. I think it's important, it's vital for you to get out and vote. Most people like to complain about what we do at City Hall, but they don't tend to vote. So if you want the opportunity to complain after the election, if you voted, you get the opportunity to complain. But that cynicism that, oh, it doesn't matter, or, you know, what happens at the City Hall doesn't impact my life. We could have had an LRT if everybody had voted properly in the city of Brampton. We could have had more jobs in the city. We could have had much better relationships with the provincial and federal government had all of council engaged and been better advocates. That's the challenge. I had two members of my council who have both been on council for 30 years. That means people never challenged them. They never had anybody question what they did. And I'm pretty sure, based on the number of people that I'm meeting every day, 13 days before an election, who said, why didn't the council do this? And why didn't the council do that? And I said, did you talk to your councillor? Do you know who your city and regional councillor are? Most people don't know. That ignorance of who's your elected official is a huge threat, I think, to this election.
Madam, you rightly talked about LRT. It was possible to have 100% construction paid the province. But why could not you carry all the councillors on this issue, and we lost so much of money and connectivity? Who you directly feel is responsible? Anyone you would like to name?
I don't think it's helpful to look over your shoulder and look in the past. I think the decision that we were told that people were making was because they wanted to protect their downtown, because they believe our downtown is historic. I don't believe that. I don't think our downtown is historic. It's an older downtown, but it isn't something I'm proud of. And I think that the decision not to put the LRT into our downtown had nothing to do with history. I think it had to do with racism. And that's an ugly thing to say. But I think that a lot of old Brampton wanted to push our newcomers to the outside of the city. I think that that's the real reason. I don't like to talk about that, but our city's changing, and the people in the downtown believe that they make all the decisions for everybody, and they don't. This is a big city. This is a city of 600,000 that's growing. We need people, all of our residents, to engage, to be part of all decisions, because I think public transit is an affordability issue for newcomers, for seniors, for students. Everyone needs good public transit, and it helps with gridlock.
Madam, 70% of Brampton population is people of color. So in city of Brampton's workforce, what percentage of people are people of color, and what you have done to make it more diverse and make it more inclusive?
So that's a big question. The only people that I control for hiring is the people in my office, and my office is diverse, very diverse. All of council hires one person, that's the CAO, Mr. Schlang, and he hires everybody else in the corporation. I don't think it's diverse enough. I've already told the CAO I want that to change. But he has to make those decisions, and I think a more diverse council will help a more diverse hiring at the City of Brampton. But what I have done is I sit on the Police Services Board, and I appointed a diverse person to be the chair of the Police Services Board. I've hired diversity at the Peel Regional Police. I don't just give the words, I give the action to deliver competent, skilled people to those jobs. It takes time to turn a big ship. City Hall has been filled with people who've been there for 30 years, and all I hear from them is, oh, we've always done it this way. When I was running for office 4 years ago, I heard people say, you want a job at City Hall? You better know somebody. You want a contract at City Hall? You better know somebody. It should never be like that. It should always be the most competent, the most skilled, the best person for the job. And that's what I try and do. I try to lead by example. But again, a council that looks all like me doesn't tend to make changes. This election, you have the chance. We're going to have probably four vacancies. For the first time in Brampton's history, we will likely have a council that looks like our city.
Madam, Brampton's emergency room, the hospital's emergency room, was prepared for 180 patients a day, and it actually takes more than double of the patients.
Yes.
And Brampton is still growing. So what efforts you have done to bring another hospital to the Brampton, which is a dire need of the people?
So as a former MPP, a member of provincial parliament, I advocated for Brampton Civic, and we built Brampton Civic. I think it's about $2 billion in healthcare. I advocated for the rebuild of Peel Memorial. It's only phase one. We actually need three phases of Peel Memorial. And I argued with the Liberal government, with Minister Hoskins, to bring more beds to Peel Memorial. I am the person that initiated a motion that said we should start looking for the land for the third hospital. But I am concerned, before we go to the third hospital, that our existing hospitals are better funded. We need phase two and phase three of Peel Memorial before we start building a hospital. Because remember, the city of Brampton has to come up with 10%. So that means I have to go back to taxpayers for more money for healthcare before the province has put in their full share to Peel Memorial. So I think it's in my responsibility to make sure we get those two hospitals up and properly funded before we start down the path of a third hospital. We're looking at it, we're planning for it, but I am concerned that without the funding for the second facility, we're going to be in trouble financially to support a third.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. Dosto, tusi vichar sune, Madam Mayor de, unhan diyan ki accomplishments sigiyan. ਹੁਣ ਆਪਾਂ ਚੱਲਦੇ ਹਾਂ ਇੱਕ ਬ੍ਰੇਕ 'ਤੇ ਔਰ ਬ੍ਰੇਕ ਤੋਂ ਬਾਅਦ ਆਪਾਂ ਉਹਨਾਂ ਦੀਆਂ ਫੇਲਰਸ ਬਾਰੇ ਵੀ ਗੱਲ ਕਰਾਂਗੇ। ਦੋਸਤੋ ਹਾਜ਼ਰ ਹਾਂ ਇਸ ਬ੍ਰੇਕ ਤੋਂ ਬਾਅਦ ਐਂਡ ਲੈਟਸ ਨਾਓ ਟਾਕ ਟੂ ਅਵਰ ਮੇਅਰ ਰਿੰਦਾ ਜਾਫਰੀ। ਮੈਮ, ਯੂ ਹੈਵ ਟਾਕਡ ਸੋ ਮੈਨੀ ਅਕੰਪਲਿਸ਼ਮੈਂਟ, ਸੋ ਮੈਨੀ ਥਿੰਗਸ ਯੂ ਡਿਡ, ਯੂ ਓਵਰਹਾਲਡ the city of Brampton. My question is, what you sincerely feel are your major failures in the last 4 years?
Well, I think we touched on it in the session before. The LRT, the light rail transit, was a huge disappointment. I don't think it was my failure because I voted for it. I would say it was council's failure, and six members of council have to sleep with themselves knowing that they took away affordable transit from the city of Brampton and that they didn't work cooperatively with the province of Ontario. Those opportunities don't come along every day. Those things are very unhelpful to a city. And I think the other issue that I would have liked council to agree to was to bring in an independent auditor general, someone who would look at the books, the finances, because I still see not using best practices. I still see questionable activities going on in City Hall. And it's my money, and it's your money, and I don't want to waste it. The other thing that bothers me is really bad decisions from council, whether it's helping a hockey team, bailing out a hockey team for $1.5 million. Imagine what we could have done with $1.5 million. More kabaddi, more cricket, more soccer. We could have helped our seniors with the bus pass. That $1.5 million, it's wasted. The other thing we did is we bought a golf course. We say it's for seniors, but it's not a senior-friendly building. There's a lot of stairs. The pool is in the basement. That's not where you would put seniors. Seniors need no stairs, and we bought it for $11 million when, in fact, it was worth four.
Okay, my question is, is there any decision where you supported and you think you wish that you should have actually not supported, so you would like to reverse any of your decisions?
No, I can't think of anything. You know, at the end of the day, you make the decisions based on the information you have in front of you. My experience and my past council and provincial experience help guide my decision making. It was a hard 3.5 years. I knew going in it was going to be difficult to get senior staff to agree. I'm proud of the decisions I made. I'm proud of the stands that I took. I had fights along the way. I tried to open up City Hall. I tried to make sure that everyone felt welcome at City Hall, and I'm proud of those decisions.
Murders, shootings, stabbings, drugs, marijuana. Bramptonians are frightened. What initiatives you are going to take to make Brampton safe and drug-free?
So my job as a mayor is occasionally I get to sit on the Police Services Board, and this term I did. So I've sat there for the last 4 years working with Chief Evans. The first couple of years were a little bumpy with the chief because we argued about carding. I don't believe in street checks. I don't believe in carding. I think it's wrong to stop visible minorities in my community arbitrarily. So we argued about that. And last year we argued about the budget, because my friends and people that have had experiences with the police contacted my office. I know someone who was robbed and the police took 3 days to get there to speak to them. That's too long. So I argued with the chief last year and talked to the police board about increasing the budget for more frontline officers. So I pushed, and we now have 37 additional frontline officers, 10 more dispatchers. But I'm not sure it's the right number yet. When I speak to the chief, I still feel like there is not a good response time. I have spoken with Minister Tobolo, the new Minister of Corrections and Community Safety at the Province of Ontario. I've talked to him about the drugs and gang money that the chief has asked for. I've supported the chief in her ask. I think we need more resources here from the province, because my residents don't feel safe.
Madam, in Brampton Board of Trade debate, you talked about the allegations about Patrick Brown's sexual misconduct. He's not being charged. He has sued CTV for $8 million. Do you think that comment was fair and warranted in that situation? Because someone is innocent until proven guilty.
I think any time somebody wants to put their name on a ballot, they need to be available and understand that their personal life will come under scrutiny. And I think anybody who wants to lead the city of Brampton had better be prepared for those tough questions. And my residents want to know, what happened with those allegations of sexual misconduct? What happened with the breaches that Mr. Brown was found guilty of by the Integrity Commissioner with regards to what he said was his assets? He lied. He was found guilty. And also what's happening with the investigations that are going on with regards to nominations in Hamilton. If you are free of guilt and you have been found innocent, then you can tell people. But Mr. Brown has not done that. He's been silent on those issues. If you want to lead the city of Brampton, you better be prepared for scrutiny of what you did before, what you're doing now, and whether or not you are free of that cloud.
You have been talking about that you can work with province, you can work with federal government. Now, Ontario government's plan to help Holloway Healthcare has ignored Brampton. How you take it?
I would say it's a little early to say that the provincial government has ignored Holloway Medicine. It's October now, and they were just elected in June. They are working with experts right now to determine what the next best course forward is. They made an announcement last week about additional long-term care beds and more investments for the next 5 years. You know what? I'm going to give them some time to figure out how to deal with this issue. Our challenge is we are a high-growth city. We need more funding, base funding, rather than just a little money here and a little money there. We need a substantial increase in the hospital funding for a high-growth community. So I think it's early. I am concerned still, but they are trying to deal with the upcoming flu season. And I have invited Minister Elliott, the new Minister of Health, to come visit Brampton, come and see for herself what we're experiencing in Brampton. And I want to work with this government to make sure Brampton has the right resources.
My second last question. You have talked about dysfunction in our council. Mm-hmm. And now there are many candidates for city councillor, for regional councillor, whom you will endorse to make your wish team so that you can get everything done in the next 4 years. Who support you and whom you will support to have your wish team?
So I realize that in this community there's a real desire for a slate of candidates. My goal here is to make sure good candidates have an opportunity to run. And what I can tell you is there are some great candidates out there running. And the good news is three members of council are retiring and one is running against me. So four seats will be vacant. And there is a great opportunity to choose some qualified, smart people that we have pharmacists running, we have lawyers running, we have small business, we have a former school trustee running. They're all good candidates. Ask them questions. You have 13 days to find out about who's running in your area. Most people that I talk to don't even know who their city and regional councillor are now. If your city councillor has done a good job for you, re-elect them. If they haven't, ask someone else who is running, find out. You have homework to do. This is your responsibility. You have four votes: mayor, city, regional, school trustee. All of those positions are important. We work together, and we need to find people that can work together. I am very excited about the new group of people. You know, the last time on council, we had seven new people, and technically I was new as well. I thought that was enough of a shakeup, but it really wasn't. This time, we actually have some people from the Filipino community, the Portuguese community, we have people from South Asian, we have a real variety of people that look and sound like our city, people who are well-educated. I think this is going to be a transformative council. I'm very excited about who's coming.
Ma'am, my question still stays. Do you endorse any names?
Well, certainly I support Councillor Gurpreet Dhillon, who was on council. I support Pat Fortini, Martin Medeiros. These are good people that worked very hard. They stood up on the LRT issue. They didn't give themselves a salary increase. They voted against giving money to a corporate bailout for a hockey team. These are individuals that stood up and did the right thing over and over and over again. They have people running with them. In the case of Gurpreet Dhillon, he has Harkirat Singh, who is a former school trustee. I find him to be very competent and knows what he's doing. I think that there are other candidates that are just as good. I want the voter to do their homework. I need them to ask the questions, find out if your candidate has done any volunteer work. I think that's a good determinant as to whether they're a strong candidate as well.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. The last opportunity I'm going to give you, why should people re-elect you? You have 1 minute.
Thank you. So I want to thank everybody who watches this show today. As we're taping this, 13 days until Election Day. And I ask, I thank you first for electing me 4 years ago and giving me a very strong mandate to change things at City Hall, and that's what I've done. I brought accountability and transparency to City Hall, but there is more work to be done. Right now, 1 in 3 people votes. Please don't let this opportunity pass you by without voting. My name is Linda Jeffrey. I look for your support. I ask that you get out to the advance polls. On Saturday, you can go to any recreation center and vote. Take your friends, your family, your aunties, your uncles, your neighbors, your business partners. Go and vote. And if you can't vote that day, get out on Election Day. And I thank you for your support.
Thank you very much, Madam Mayor.
Welcome.
Friends, you have listened to Madam Mayor. Prime Asia Television does not support any candidate. It does not oppose any candidate. Our job is to ensure that our candidate shares thoughts so that you can make well-informed, well-educated decisions. Thank you very much for watching the show.
ਹੁਣ ਹਰ ਰੋਜ਼ ਆਪਣੇ ਫੇਵਰਿਟ ਸ਼ੋਅ ਦੇਖਣ ਲਈ ਹੋਵੇਗੀ ਭੱਜ ਨੱਠ ਕਿਉਂਕਿ ਬ੍ਰਿਟ ਏਸ਼ੀਆ ਤੇ ਪ੍ਰਾਈਮ ਏਸ਼ੀਆ ਨੇ ਮਿਲਾ ਲਏ ਨੇ ਹੱਥ ਹਰ ਰੋਜ਼ ਦੇਖੋ ਪ੍ਰਾਈਮ ਏਸ਼ੀਆ ਟੀਵੀ ਦੇ ਹਿੱਟ ਸ਼ੋਜ਼ ਹੁਣ ਬ੍ਰਿਟ ਏਸ਼ੀਆ ਟੀਵੀ ਤੇ ਦੇਸ਼ ਦੁਨੀਆ ਦੀਆਂ ਖਬਰਾਂ ਲਈ ਪ੍ਰਾਈਮ ਨਿਊਜ਼ ਸਵੇਰੇ 7 ਵਜੇ ਪ੍ਰਾਈਮ ਵੂਮਨ ਬੇਸਡ ਔਨ ਵੂਮਨਸ ਇਸ਼ੂਜ਼ ਸਵੇਰੇ 7:30 ਵਜੇ ਕਲਚਰਲ ਸ਼ੋਅ ਵਿਦ 뮤직 ਪ੍ਰਾਈਮ ਜ਼ਿੰਦਗੀ ਸਵੇਰੇ 8 ਵਜੇ ਰਿਲੀਜੀਅਸ ਇਸ਼ੂਜ਼ ਲਈ ਪ੍ਰਾਈਮ ਚਰਚਾ ਤੇ ਐਂਟਰਟੇਨਮੈਂਟ ਲਈ ਪ੍ਰਾਈਮ ਟਾਈਮ ਸਵੇਰੇ 9 ਵਜੇ ਬੇਸਡ ਔਨ ਡੇਲੀ ਕਰੰਟ ਪੋਲਿਟੀਕਲ ਇਸ਼ੂਜ਼ ਪ੍ਰਾਈਮ ਫੋਕਸ ਸ਼ਾਮ 5 ਵਜੇ ਜੱਜ ਦਾ ਵਿਚਾਰ ਮਿਊਜ਼ੀਕਲ ਕਾਮੇਡੀ ਸ਼ੋਅ ਐਂਡ ਇੰਟਰਵਿਊਜ਼ ਵਿਦ ਪੰਜਾਬੀ ਸਟਾਰਸ ਸ਼ਾਮ 6 ਵਜੇ ਬੇਤੜਕ ਤੇ ਪੱਖਪਾਤ ਰਹਿਤ ਸੀਨੀਅਰ ਪੱਤਰਕਾਰ ਜਤਿੰਦਰ ਪੰਨੂ ਜੀ ਦਾ ਸ਼ੋਅ ਪ੍ਰਾਈਮ ਡਿਸਕਸ਼ਨ ਦੇਖੋ ਸ਼ਾਮ 7 ਵਜੇ ਤੇ ਕੀ ਰਿਹਾ ਅਖਬਾਰਾਂ ਦੀਆਂ ਸੁਰਖੀਆਂ ਚ ਦੱਸਣਗੇ ਸਵਰਨ ਟੈਣਾ ਖਬਰ ਦੀ ਖਬਰ ਸ਼ਾਮ 7:30 ਵਜੇ ਸੋ 50 ਦੇ ਕਰੀਬ ਦੇਸ਼ਾਂ ਚ ਵਸਦੇ ਪੰਜਾਬੀਆਂ ਦੇ ਟੀਵੀ ਸੈਟਸ ਤੇ ਸਕਾਈ ਟੀਵੀ ਚੈਨਲ 743 ਵਰਜਨ ਟੀਵੀ ਚੈਨਲ 840 ਪ੍ਰੀਵਿਊ ਚੈਨਲ ਨੰਬਰ 264 ਤੇ ਬ੍ਰਿਟਿਸ਼ਿਆ ਟੀਵੀ ਹੈ ਜਿੱਥੇ ਪ੍ਰਾਈਮ ਏਸ਼ੀਆ ਟੀਵੀ ਹੈ ਉੱਥੇ